All systems are go. Let's double check to make sure everything works. Check. Let's start the live stream like Nick Mirror. Shout out to Nick Mirror. I just saw somebody posted his live stream, I guess, from Twitch. So you can follow him on Twitch. Nick Mirror, I'm following him on Twitch. I just don't get on Twitch enough to watch folks. But shout out to Nick Mirror. The video I saw had it opened up with him singing melodies or like singing. I don't know what he was doing. I didn't watch the whole video. Lemire is here. Shout out to you. So I don't know what Nick Mirror was doing the whole video. I mean, in the whole entire video, but I know he started off singing. So let's start off with some melodies. I'm going to use our brain. I think, what's up? Baby Rage is here. Seymour's here. J-Rex, welcome. I don't have my sound effects queued up, but shout out to y'all. Kevin Ortiz is here. Let me run this background music real quick. So we're going to focus today on beat making and music theory and like how much music theory do producers need. I think there's a confusion sometimes when I speak about music theory that people think you have to always use all these techniques all the time. And the short of it is that music theory is much more than just minor chord, you know, major chord. You have to know about sound effects, how to like manipulate the samples to reverse them, just pitch them out, stretch them, and then layer stuff on top. You know, it's more than just playing notes straight through, like typical traditional music theory. And that's our difference, is we teach you the modern day music theory, because I'm showing you it's not only just playing a minor chord. You got to play the minor chord. You got to know how to, you know, stretch it, reverse it, twist it, fake it, watch it, turn it, flip it, top-o-matic. You got to know how to do all that. All right, so Kevin is here. We got Horcrux beats. Probably saying that wrong. J-Rax, shout out to you. Kevin's here. Sensei is always dope when I'm watching your vids. Thank you for hopping in live. It's an experience. And again, I'm going to tackle questions as we go, but I want to make this more of a flow, showing you that, you know, beat making is one craft. You don't necessarily need to know music theory, but there's a different level of music production when you understand the music theory and then how to get to the end outcomes. Because a lot of people, again, they know how to play a minor chord. They don't know how to think in the mind to go, okay, I can time stretch this, pitch it up an octave, reverse it, and then layer that over a minor ninth chord. They don't understand like the whole process. So I'm going to show you a couple things. Not to say we're going to run into everything tonight, but we have some complimentary courses for you. It's pinned to the YouTube chat. We are now starting the music theory series. So we're going to be focusing on music theory topics on this channel. Probably for a week, we'll focus on music theory. Ivan's here. Quick question. Any thoughts on future snare? Future snare. Is that a genre? I'm unaware of what you're asking. I don't know if that's a genre, a sound, or future the rapper snare. It'd be like five things in my head. I'm not quite sure what you mean there. But again, I appreciate everybody for even opening up the notification or however you found this live. I appreciate y'all. Even the folks on Facebook and Twitch. Let me pull up the chat. I forgot to pull up the chat. So if you guys are on Facebook or Twitch, we have 70 folks here, 75 folks here worldwide. I appreciate every soul for hopping in with us. I want to say thank you first before we get into it. Okay, so I want to see what you're asking. Favorite channel says Beats of Hip Hop. Thank you. Bakari's here. Lav Versalovic. Okay, shout out to you for hopping in. Swish Major's here in the building, taking a break from writing my 10,000 word law paper. My man's in law school. Shout out to you, getting wealthy in the mind. I can appreciate law because law is all about logic, and it's about how to solve a problem. Like it's about organization of the mind. I like law. It's like you could look at something from what I learned about law. Here's the one thing I learned about law is, dang, I had a cool phrase to tell y'all. There's 360 degrees, which means there's a minimum of 360 perceptions on something. I said that out of like, it didn't sound so poetic, but basically because there's 360 degrees to a circle, there's at least 360 perspectives on something. And ironically, Day Day just posted, shout out to my baby. She just posted on Instagram a song about, and forgive me if I'm taking this out of context, but from the way I understood it was stepping outside of ourselves and seeing us in the third person. You know, that's a different perspective. So that's one of the 360 degrees. And that's the minimum, because we got to think tertiary angles, you know, different dimensions, all that type of stuff. Seneth is here. We got Playboy says, what's up? Oh, did I say that right, baby? I didn't want to like misquote you. I was taking a chance. So hopefully I understood the message. There she is. Shout out to my baby. She's right there. But go follow her on Instagram. She just posted. Here, I'll put her Instagram handle real quick. And I love you, baby, for hopping in. Thank you. Wait, that spelled right? D-E-Y, D-E-Y. That's her Instagram. And go listen to the lyrics of the song that she just posted, like the performance clip. So we were just talking about that. That's wild how the universe synced that up. That's wild. We're just talking about perspective. So Swish Major, good luck in your law paper. 10,000 words is what? That's what? How many pages is this? 10,000 words. You figure you have 200 words per page. So that's what? 10,000 divided by 200. Is that a 500-page essay? I know I'm not doing that math right. Shout out to Ghost is here. We got Redante here. We got Heba. Oh, here's a little trick for y'all. Here's how I made my book 128 pages. You ready? What you have to do is you go into your spacing and put it on double space. And that will like double the length of your book. So put it on double. Again, I forget all the proper terms, but the double spacing. Little trick for everybody in high school and college. Put it on double space. You will double your essay just that quick. That's a random trick I learned at Villanova University. Who else is up in this piece? True Duke is here. We got Ibrel. Welcome. Peace to everyone. And what's goody? What's goody? Sam Goody. My song just stopped. What happened to my song here? I need my backtrack. I need my Moesha music. Okay. Sean is here. Always learning. Aaron, yo game, what it do? I got some questions for us, so look out for you. Okay. I'm looking. All right, we got some folks on Facebook. I just want to say what's up. Devok is here. We got Richie here. I know Fruity Loops user face when I see it. Oh, exactly. Juan is here on Facebook. Ronald is here. We got Sean's on Facebook. Shout out to you. Steven's on Facebook. What's up, Russell? What's going on? One of the first. I remember you from like, I don't even know what year it was. I want to say when we first started getting serious. So he's an OG of this channel. Faiso Mula, shout out to y'all and anybody on Twitch who's watching this. All right, so shout out to everybody. I know I didn't say what's up to everybody, so I'm gonna quickly say it, and then we're gonna get straight into it. Jay Henry's here, Lil T's here, we got Joseph, Anthony's here. What's up? Heba says, you guys work with pages in the Netherlands, we count the words instead. But how would a teacher know how many words you wrote unless they had the file? Like, how do they just look at a paper and go, this is 20,000 words on this piece of paper? That's tough to do. Ancient Modesty, what's up? Oh, you mean like, this book is 80,000 words long. But what if it just had the word the? Then the book wouldn't be that long. But if it had long words, it'd be super long. I like pages. America gets away with skimping on everything. Pages, pounds, we just make our own stuff up. Nick is here, what's up? All right, so let's get this thing rock. Oh, do you know where I can get marching band samples? Yes, it's called, you're pulling my brain from a contact library I used so many years ago, and I forgot I actually had it. I don't think I have it on this computer, but you reminded me that I bought a contact library that was on my other computer. It's called Sound Iron, I forget what the name is. But it's by Sound Iron, and it's called High School Drum Corps by Sound Iron. It's a contact library. I bought it years and years ago. It says it's $50 on Plug and Boutique, but I don't see it anywhere else. So I'm gonna, here it is. It's $31 on the website. Oh no, it's $49. I stand corrected. But this is what you need for that marching band sound. They sampled a marching band. So I would say if you're looking specifically for that sound, this is the one right here. So it's by Sound Iron called High School Drum Corps. So that's what it is. Okay, let's get into the beat making. Let's get into the music theory. Just wanted to say my hellos. Let's make this watchable. People who are watching the replay, Crossroad is here. What's up? So the first, again, I'm going through the natural process. I'm not gonna like overly do music theory where I wouldn't normally do it. So the first step that I usually go through is I start with the melody in my head. And this is the problem most producers have. They're like, how do you make melodies? What plugin makes melodies? Like, your brain has to have the melody first. And the point of the computer is trying to recreate what you hear in your brain. So this is an exercise you could do for free, assuming you have a smartphone. You go on your smartphone, you go to the notes section or the voice memo section, and you just record a melody straight into it. So I'm going to do that right now. And let's record to 140 BPM just to kind of stay in pocket. Let's turn the metronome on. My brain's just going to make up stuff. Thank you. I wish y'all could. You know what I realized on that track? I rendered out the lesser quality audio, and I didn't check it. And I thought it was going to sound nice and big and wide and everything like the original file did. But my video editing software compressed the audio into a different format. So it sounds a lot smaller. So, yeah, the original sounds huge. Okay, so what was I going to do? I forgot that quick. Oh, we're going to do melodies. So let me get used to the BPM first. Oh, and you know what we're going to do? Let's load up auto-tune just so we can... I'm trying to debate. Should we start with auto-tune or... Yes, let's start with auto-tune. First, I need to figure out what key. So I'm going to load up another plugin that I think you should have in your arsenal. It's called Scalar 2 by Plugin Boutique. I like Jay Cactus's approach. I like to let the young kids like have their thing. I don't like to overly arch over other folks. Jay Cactus focuses specifically on drill, so I'm going to let him shine. And then, you know, over time, I'll do my drill videos. I don't like to step on like the younger class who's coming up, because that's their own, you know, that's their way of getting noticed, basically. Okay, so here, let's figure out what key we're in. Okay, so I want those notes, so let's record it. No beefs, just beats, I saw that. All right, we're in the key of C minor, so let's start with C minor. Let's load up auto-tune. Now, I usually don't, again, I record straight into my phone, I don't load up auto-tune, but I want to show you guys. Entourage sent me these plugins. This is Auto-Tune Pro. We're going to put it in the scale of C minor. So we're going to put it on minor. Retune speed fast, just so I can like know that I'm in key or not. And I usually put auto-tune as the first step in my chain. It's a little hard for me to hear auto-tune, so I'm going to sing stuff just so I can hear myself. Oh, you know what? Also, I like to put it on alto tenor mode. It tends to react to my voice a little bit better. So, okay, so it sounds like we're partially in key. What snap to grid do I use for the pain trap beats? In the piano roll, I use 1/2 beat. In the playlist, I should have put piano roll. Hold on. 1/2 beat. And in the playlist, I use snap to grid. So the biggest one in the playlist. And then in the piano roll, 1/2 beat. How you make piano chords. Thank you. Yeah, we're going to get into the music theory. I'm just going step by step so people understand the process. So what I'm going to do is just lay down multiple melodies. Another trick is to run your voice through effects. So let's open up some effects. If you want to get like Travis Scott, you would add a saturator. So let's do FabFilter Saturn. And then what we're going to do is open up another plugin. Just give me a second. Three seconds, y'all. Hold up. All right. So now we're going to run it through a saturator. Check, 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 check. You hear my voice get more bitey? This is the Travis Scott effect, I'll call it. Let's put it on clean tube. Clean tube. Now, to be fair, what we're going to do is isolate a specific range. So let's isolate everything above 250 to about, let's just do everything above 250. And then let's turn off these other things. Let's turn the amount down. So this is off for the bass, but then the high end has that sizzle. So that's how I'm going to pull out the harmonics in my voice. And then you can pull down the drive amount or the mix level. You know, this is kind of like a sweet spot. All right. Now to get Travis Scott, I would probably load up CLA vocals. I don't have the sound effect. Okay, this is gonna give you the reverb, the delay, and all those other things. Let's do a long reverb. Now again, I usually don't put reverb directly on a track. This is just to hear yourself through effects. Okay, so let's compress my voice. And now I have a very big voice. So now when I'm doing melodies, I'll hear it as a final product, and it changes the way you make the melody. Okay, so that's, let's just do random stuff to 140, and then we're gonna build around it. So basically, you create your own acapella and then build around that. So that's the process. Let's go to song mode, let's go to record. Audio into playlist is an audio clip. Let me make sure I'm in on the right audio driver. Yeah, yeah. Okay. Keep hearing these clicks in the background, I don't know where it's from. Wait, that was terrible. DJ Wraith is here, what's up? And I tracked before. Oh, that's what you decided on, you're saying, from the other day. Shout out to you. Okay, so you just start with your brain, okay? Your brain's gonna come up with the melody. Now we're gonna build around that with the music. So my whole goal is to show you that your brain should have the idea before the computer has the idea. And most people, they go into the computer trying to force an idea. And that's why you don't have, it doesn't sound right. Because you're not building it around real dynamics of your voice or real thoughts. It's just like a made up thing. Okay, so let's go to song mode. So that's the biggest thing I see with earlier producers. They usually don't, like their drums don't match a human voice, the pocket of a human voice. So just do that quick exercise. Again, you don't have to do it in your DAW. You could do it on your phone and then import it into your DAW. So here we have the vocal. We're going to treat this like an acapella. Acapella. And we're going to cut out the lows. Let's do this. Cut out the lows. Let's do a high pass. Okay, so now we're going to pick the sounds around that voice. So the reason I added the effects is also we're going to fill up as much space as possible with the hearing ourselves so that we don't overly fill a beat. If I would have recorded dry or not at all, the problem to making the beat is that we're going to overfill the beat because subconsciously we want to put stuff where a vocal should be. Like as a producer, we don't realize how much space a vocal takes up. Like even a raw recording, if I went to my other mic back there and just recorded just with no effects, it takes up a lot of space. And we want to leave space for the vocal so that it doesn't get buried in the beat. And that usually happens when we don't build the beat with the vocal in mind. So all I'm saying is I'm giving you techniques you could use to leave more space. So that's the first biggest problem I see with producers. Also, the rhythms that they use are kind of not matching a human timing. Okay. Let me compress this a little bit more just so it's a little more linear. Let's do, I'm trying to think of a compressor I could use. Let's do, I think, what is it called? Here it is. Alicia Impressor. So I'm just doing this so that it stays linear. So I would not use this on vocals. This is just for demonstration purposes. Just trying to keep that vocal in its spot. Okay, so now we have that taken care of. We need to figure out sound selection. So let's open up. You guys tend to like Analog Lab. So let's use Analog Lab. I heard Arteria just came out with a distortion plugin called Cold Fire, I think it's called. Now here's where I like using my keyboard because we have built-in chords. So I'm going to demo it using these chords. Okay. It's just quicker to play because sometimes I don't know every key. So it's harder to play quickly. How long have you been producing? Since I was 14 and I'm 31 now, so what's that make? 17 years. But let's say focus, since I made this YouTube channel, I'd say since 2014. So what? That's eight years almost. I use TrueVerb and Pro Tools, but Evo gave me a better feel. For some reason, I have a question about the kick and snare push-pull effect. Did you watch that video with George T. Music and freaking Jason Joshua's True Verb effect? You had to. There's no way you just talk about True Verb out of nowhere. You had to watch that video. So what he's talking about is if you add an early reflection, like, let me just say it in simple terms, because I know your question, because I just watched the same video from George T. Music, is, I'm trying to think of a way to demonstrate this. I need 3 seconds to figure this out. Okay, I'm going to exaggerate my compressor just so you could hear. So if I clap my hands, it's not the greatest. Hold on, let me do this louder. There you go. Okay, so if I clap my hands, you're going to hear more of the room. Like, you hear the depth of the room. So those are called early reflections. It's basically the reflections that come back to you fast, usually within 10 feet. Okay, so if you're in a physical room and you speak, an early reflection is when, you know, your voice travels in all directions at the same time. It doesn't just travel straight. So that's the first myth we have to break. Okay, so when you're speaking, it goes everywhere. So it's going to hit the wall that's closest to you first, then it's going to go back to the microphone. Okay, so it's going to go forward, then backward to the microphone. And the microphone hears your original voice, and then it hears the thing bouncing off the wall. Sound travels at 340 meters a second. So, you know, I don't know the math in milliseconds, but you could do the math for yourself. And so there's an initial sound, there's a sound that bounces off the wall, and then it comes back a little bit later. Okay, so that's called an early reflection. To exaggerate that, I'm going to use what's called delay. Let's just use the simple delay. All right. Okay. Okay. So an early reflection is, it's just so small of a time difference, you can't tell that it's a delay, but it's basically a delay, a small delay. Check. Okay. I'll lower this, and then it will sound like we're getting closer to an object. So you can see I'm talking and there's a delay. There's like a time response. Okay, so that's, and then you gotta think sound loses energy based on the material that it hits. So usually a sound coming back to you is not full volume. It's gonna be muffled a little bit based on the sound. So you have a low pass filter usually. So you're speaking, there's a delay, low-pass filter on that sound because it degraded it. It's not the same sound hitting off the wall, okay, based on the material. So that's the concept of an early reflection. So again, you have early reflections not only in front of you, you have them to the sides, you have them to the left, the right, the behind you. And so reverb algorithms create it to where, like, they do the math for you. They simulate you being in a false environment. So what he's showing you in the video that you probably saw, the same one as me, is he'll push stuff to the back, perceived back, by pushing the echolocation of a sound back using this simulation of a room called reverb. So in TrueVerb, I don't have that plugin though. I wish I could pull it up for you. Do I have a reverb plugin by Waves? I think I have UAD's Real Verb, that might be the same. This is different. Give me a second. UAD has a reverb called, not Real Verb, but give me a second, y'all. My brain's gonna freeze until I figure it out. It's either Real Verb or, darn, I forget what it's called. Let's just use Real Verb. Oh, Dream Verb, that's the one I'm thinking about. Okay, so Real Verb uses, again, this is what I just talked about. The sound base bounces off of a material. Okay, so that's why you have a material knob here, because every sound, if I'm talking and you hear my sound off of, let me turn this off for a second. If I'm talking and you hear my voice coming off of concrete, it's gonna sound more solidified because concrete has more mass, so it's gonna bounce back quicker. But that's why acoustic paneling, when you speak into an acoustic panel, it takes the sound and it slows it down. So it doesn't return or returns at a very low volume to where you can't hear. That's why people have acoustic paneling in the room. Now, the shape of the room is just, what size is the room? Is it a square? Is it a rectangle? That's how they base these calculations, like how fast my voice is going to come back to me. So that's why in reverbs, I said all that to say, that was a lot. Let me see if I lost a lot of people, because I said this is about music theory and I started talking about freaking mixing. But this is important. So basically an early reflection is the quicker something gets back to you. A late reflection is the wall that's really far away from you and the sound comes back and it sounds more like a delay. So let me just open up the delay again just to demonstrate this one more time. So with delay, check. You hear how it sounds like delay? There's a point where in a reverb where it goes beyond the early reflections point. And thank you, Asol. You said excellent info. Thank you. It goes beyond that early reflection point. So there's a point in this delay. So you'll notice if I start low, okay, it sounds close. But if I start pulling this up, I sound further and further away. And then there's a point where it sounds like delay. Okay, so there's a magic spot there that they calculate with these reverbs. So all that to say, early reflections is how you push something. You give it depth, perceived depth based on our ears' echolocation abilities. So that's why he was using TrueVerb, because it has early reflection capabilities. I'm pretty sure you could do it with FL stuff as well. This might not be as easy. This reverb is kind of hard to read. So I would do it here, but it's hard to read. So you see the distance knob? This is pushing something to the back. So let me exaggerate. So depending on the distance, check. And then we have, where's our, that's the rec early. That's panning. So these curvatures determine your far and your short delay. That's why I said there's a lot about this plugin specifically. So I'm not going to act like an expert on this plugin. But you can hear, check. You hear that delay. Check. Okay, so that's what distance is doing, creating that check. That delay effect. So again, you just gotta, I guess in TrueVerb it's probably made a little bit more simple. Okay, so without going off onto a tangent about mixing, my fault. That was just, it was on my mind because I just watched that video. So I just wanted to explain that. All right, back to music theory. Okay, yeah. So let's talk about music theory and making beats. I appreciate all 100 of you guys in here. Jason Joshua is just becoming one of the faces of mixing right now. Pensado is always gonna be a GOAT. Jason Joshua is like the new face of mixing, and people like to copy, you know, like to learn from his techniques. All right, so, okay, let's get into music theory. So again, I'm gonna use this keyboard because it has the chords built in, and I'm gonna play these behind my vocals that I just did. Okay, so I'm just freestyling with these chords, and then we'll break down the chord type and the voicing as to why it sounds like it. So I'm just playing two chords, starting off with the tonic or the C minor. And then we have D, E, F. Okay, so 1, 2. Playing harder. I messed up the ending because I didn't. Wait, let's see where we're gonna go. We need it. It's not giving me that note. So we're gonna have to draw it in or figure it out. So here's where music theory comes into play. So even if I'm using a MIDI controller that has all these chords built in, we still have to go in sometimes and fix stuff. Okay, so let's quantize first. We're gonna hit Control Q. Now, if you notice, here's the more poetic way of explaining this, is that I played softer in the beginning and then I played harder over time so that it created a different articulation to the sound. So the short of it is that you get, you said Pro Tools, I meant Auto-Tune and Waves TrueVerb. Oh, I thought you were talking about the, I went on a whole tangent for nothing, is what you're telling me. I thought you were talking about, what's his name, Jason Joshua's thing. Dag, I just gave y'all a whole essay about for nothing. Well, at least now you know. Okay, so what was I saying here? So I played softly in the beginning and then I played harder over time. So something that is like a subtle music theory thing is that sometimes your beat doesn't need new things. It doesn't need new chords or new sound. Your sound needs to move. And that's the difference between a lot of older music and today's music. It says, not for nothing, thank you, DJ Ray. Is that a lot of older music had more modulation to it. So if I'm playing on my synths behind me, you know, I can move a knob as I'm playing it. So you get a lot more movement and a lot more excitement. So think about your sound. You don't have to do it this way all the time, but I'm saying how sometimes you don't need to play the same, you know, different chords. Like for example, here's C minor. You see how it's soft and very R&B-ish? If I hit it harder, you get a bitier sound, you get more harmonics. And I can show you this real quick. Let's route this to the mixer real quick and load up this plugin called Wave Candy. So if you ever want to check out, where's the thing? Hold on. Let's do this and put it on here. Okay, so if I play soft, these are the harmonics of the sound. Very low. Our max frequency is about 750 hertz. Now, if I play this instrument harder, this is not the case for all instruments, by the way. You see, if I play it harder, now we're getting higher and higher frequencies. So now the highest frequency is way up at 8K, just by playing it harder. Okay, so sometimes you don't need new chords, you just need to introduce a higher velocity to the sound because that will trigger a different articulation, which will give you more harmonics to the sound, which make a sound feel more full. So you don't always need new sounds to add in stuff is basically the point. Okay, so we have C minor here. And what we're doing here in this voicing is raising what's called the third. So this is done in R&B. Somebody asked about pain beats earlier. So a lot of pain beats, they raise that third. The same with EDM, the same with a lot of R&B. They just raise the third. Now, if you're gonna raise the third, usually for EDM, they'll have simple triads. I know I'm getting a little in the weeds about, you know, music theory right now, but let me pull this down. So if you have C, E, G in a row like this, in EDM, they'll raise the E up an octave. It's a little hard to hear because it's such a soft sound. Let me do it with the scalar piano. So instead of playing C, E, G is a normal triad voicing, meaning just straight through going up the keyboard, what we can do now, open up the piano roll. What we can do now is raise this E up an octave. And they'll usually stack it with a bass, another bass below using the root note. And that's how you get that full sound. So there's a lot to explain, but what I'm saying is sometimes you don't need new chords. You can use a triad. It's just you need to understand the voicing of a chord. Sometimes you don't need to play a new chord. Maybe you need to add that bass octave to it, which is just playing the same note in the bass. The screen might be a little small, so let me make it bigger for y'all real quick. Okay, there was G, E. So see, we get a nice spread of frequencies. So it's not about what notes we're playing, it's about what frequencies we are triggering. So you're getting this nice big sound. I'll hold this. Let me record this just so we can see the difference. Okay, so let's play this versus a simple triad. I forgot we're playing on the pattern, sorry about that. Don't mind the other piano. I forgot we're on this pattern. Let's move this to a new pattern. Okay, so I just want you to hear tonally, when you voice chords differently, you get a bigger sound. You don't always need more instruments. So I'm showing you the little things that you won't learn until later in music theory, but I'm showing you them now because once you understand you don't need a gazillion things, playing a gazillion things, you'll understand. You'll appreciate music theory more, in my opinion. The BPM for R&B, there's no set BPM. If you're talking about like plug-in B, you're going to be in double time. So you're looking at, you know, I'm trying to think plug-in B. I think they all go to all the way down to like the 70. So I would say 140 up to 180 is about the plug-in B. If you're talking about classic R&B, yeah, it's really slow. You know, that's slow R&B. It depends. There's a lot of R&B. I don't know what type of R&B. If you're talking about modern stuff, plug and B. If you're talking about like Brandy style R&B? It depends on what R&B. Is it dancing? Are you going to be dancing with the R&B? Because if so, then you're going 91, 93. Are you going Moesha R&B like this sound right here? Because it has a different purpose. So it just depends. I don't mean to give you such a blanket answer, but it's just not that cut and dry. Okay, so my point is, okay, going back to voicing, here's when you voice a chord spread across the frequency. Again, when you think about chords like frequency, it makes sense. Oh, Aaron said he's working on pain beats. Thank you for adding me so I could see it. Yeah, guys, if you have something specifically for me, just at BusyWorks Beats, because on my screen, it's very hard to read. And if you put at BusyWorks Beats, it shows up as orange, so I can see it a lot more clearly. Because it's a black background with white text. And it's like, who, you know, I grew up reading a white background with black text, so it's very hard to read that. Here's the voicing. So here's one chord versus another. Keith Sweat. I would listen to Keith Sweat specifically, and then, yeah, we're talking like 70s. So 70 through, I'd say 90 is probably the highest if you're going that route. To your page, your YouTube page, hold on. YouTube fixed it to where I click go channel, it actually goes to your channel now. So they fixed it. Okay, so I got to get on with the lesson here, but here's the voicing. So my whole point to showing you guys this is just sometimes, again, I'm going to say it again like a broken record. Sometimes it's not what you play. You know, simple triad could sound big. It's just you got to learn how to play it on your keyboard. That's a very big sound as opposed to the normal way, which is just playing them in a row. Oh, I forgot I switched it to 77 BPM. I was like, why is this so slow? Let's go back up to 140. See how thin that sounds? Okay, so that's, I'm showing you little things. Okay, so going back to our chord progression. Again, it's about the velocity, how hard you hit a note. It also depends how the sampler or how the plugin was made. Not every plugin is the same to where if you hit it harder, the instrument will play a different articulation, which will give you more harmonics. It's not always that way. Favorite instrument's a guitar, but I don't know how to play it though. About how long would you say it took you to learn piano? Really, I can show you how to learn in a minute, but I don't want to sidetrack people right now. Look at my chord code video. Just type this in the YouTube and I'll show you how to literally play piano in like a second. You just need to know what you're doing on the piano. It's not that you need to, you know, do all this with the piano. It's just most of the time you need to know what chord you're playing. That's really the key to piano. Okay, so I don't want to go off on a side tangent, side mission here, side quest as MG would say. So the voicing of this chord is raising the third. Okay, so what I'm showing you here is with bigger chords like a seventh or a ninth chord, you have enough notes to play around with. It's almost where it's like a mini scale. And you could take that third and now pull it up an octave or down an octave. Usually for EDM, they're going to pull up the octave on a simple triad. So a C, E, G, the way I just played it, like this basic, instead of playing those notes, they'll take the E up an octave with just those three notes. But you know. I don't know all the chords per note, but that's what I just play. C, G, E. See how it has that pop type sound? That's where they get it from, raising that third. Okay, so they do it for R&B and they do it for EDM. But the difference is for R&B, usually they're playing a seventh chord or a ninth chord because it gives you more notes to play with. I can't pronounce your name, but it says, do beats always be lower than 0 dB since not all the time. You could add a clipper to your track and have it, you know, super clip. Clipping is that's a different lesson too. Okay, so so the C minor, what is this, 9 here? C minor ninth chord is with the third raised up an octave. So that's called a different voicing. Then you have the F minor ninth chord, and this is regular voicing. Then you have the C minor ninth, again, changed up the third, up an octave. Then you have F minor ninth. Then you have, so if you guys play chords and like, what chord did I play? Most of the time your notes are gonna be moved around or voiced differently. So we're gonna pull this one down again. Which note was pulled up an octave? The third. So that's a common theme for this style of voicing, is raising that third. Darren says, I produce trance music, but I would watch all your time and you help me so much. Thank you. Testimonial by Darren. Yeah, a lot of people like to base stuff in genres. This music theory is music theory across the board. It's, there's no, you know, it applies to everything. So we're playing the same chords, C minor ninth, F minor ninth, and then going back and forth. Actually, I don't think this is a minor ninth right here. This is a special chord type. Now, again, what we teach at BusyWorksBeats.com in our Music Theory in a Day course, I'll type it in the chat, Music Theory in a Day. I show people how to look at MIDI and decipher chords. Like, for example, you're like, why does this chord sound different? What type of chord is it? There's a way to figure it out. So what we do is we use chord codes. So starting here, let's count it up. So it's 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. So I know this is the beginning of a major triad. Whenever you see 0 and 4, it's the beginning of a major triad. Then, 5, 6, 7. So this is a major triad chord. Then we have 8, 9, 10, 11. So this is a major seventh. And then 12, 13, 14. Okay, so that's just a major ninth. I thought it was going to be one of the add chords because I forget what I played on my pad. So let's revoice that to where it was. Okay, so I think the third was raised up an octave. So it's the same thing, raising the third up an octave. I think at the end I got exotic. So see how we're following the melody of the vocal? We're just backing it up and supporting it with the chords. Now I'll give you like the gist. For R&B, you usually use seventh chords. For jazz, you're going ninth chords and above. They give you those more lush, emotional sounds. You know, if I play, let's play like a D minor ninth chord. Sounds very jazzy and lush. You know, it has more motion to it. Whereas if I play a D minor chord, it's just kind of stale and very basic. But it just has a different emotion to it. More, I'd say, dark in this case. So those are simple triads. A seventh chord is gonna give you that flexibility. Like modern trap right now, they use seventh chords. They're four note chords and you could do a lot with them. No, that's a ninth chord, sorry. Okay, so with seventh, they give you enough notes to move around. That's the gist. Ninth chords and above are gonna be jazzier tones, very lush and very, like in this style, very smooth sounding. And then anything below a seventh can be turned into very gritty, hard sounding. It's very hard to make a seventh chord sound dark. Like I can take a G minor. Let's go down an octave. It sounds very dark. But once you turn this into a G minor seventh, I'm trying to do this with one hand, hold on. I'm trying to get my pinky to stretch, okay. Let me go up an octave. It's just hard to make a G minor seventh sound dark and aggressive. And that's because you're adding what's called a perfect, I said perfect fifth, but then the seventh is gonna give you that extra tone. Now if I take that away, now it sounds villainous. Very hard to make a seventh chord sound dark. And I think that's why once you go from seventh chords and above, it just sounds softer. So that's my theory. I would have to test it. So the more notes, the more soft a chord sounds because you're creating harmony, which is not aggressive. Aggressiveness is dissonance. And that's my theory. Thank you for my TED Talk. Coming to my TED Talk. Okay, so let's fix the chords at the end here. So at the end, I kind of picked the wrong chord. So I'll show you how to pick the right chord. So what we teach in our Music Theory in a Day, for example, and I updated it at premium.busyworksbeats.com. I updated the site so that you guys have fresh, new material. And let me type this in the chat. Hold on. Premium.busyworksbeats.com. We even have complimentary courses for you guys to get started. Click here for music production courses. Okay, so if you guys want depth and you want to understand this stuff so you know what the heck you're doing and how to be flexible when you're creating your music, so you can take the idea in your head and actually create it in your DAW so that there's no roadblocks, no random tutorials to go watch and how to figure out, like hope that somebody played the right chord that you want to play. I show you why you do stuff and how to do it so that you have the arsenal to actually apply it, which is the key. Because you want to create music like this. You don't want to wait every time you want to make a song and watch a Metro Boomin tutorial. Then you have an idea for a Zaytoven type beat, then you have to watch a Zaytoven video. You want to have this skill set inside of you so that you go, okay, I want to make a Metro Boomin beat today. Let me just do it. Okay? So at the end, we need to figure out what chord we want. So let's listen to what tone our brain wants to hear. Then we're going to go. Okay, I want at the end. So let's drag this out. So dun, dun. Let's get the timing right. Let me drag this chord out. Give me 3 seconds here. Okay, so what I teach also is how to reverse engineer chord. Chord codes are very powerful. So what we're going to do is actually build a chord from this one note. So what happens is our brain hears this entire symphony. It hears the violins, the French horns, the tubas, and then we go to our DAW and we're confused on what we're doing. Or excuse me, when we record our melody, we can only record one note at a time in the phone. So that's why I did this technique, record my vocal idea first, so we're building around it, and then we're adding the notes from the other sounds around it. So the problem with the human voice is that you can only do one voice at a time. I've only seen one person sing two notes at a time, and this was like a meme from back in 2016. Some lady was singing like two notes from her vocal cords. I don't know how she did it. But as a human, you can only sing, for the most of us, one note at a time. So again, you have this whole orchestra in your head. Dun, 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 dun. Like even me singing it to you. Dun, 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 dun. I can only sing one note at a time. So the question is, how do you harmonize and fill out the other notes that you hear? And this is why chord codes are so important. So what I tell people to do is I say, write the melody that's in your head. Dun, 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 and then we can harmonize it after. Thank you, DJ Ray. Then we can harmonize it after. The Mongolian chant, funny. So we can harmonize it after. So here's what we're gonna do. We're gonna do process of elimination using chord codes. Most chords are gonna be major or minor. So depending on the context, I'm gonna assume that it's the same chord type as the chord that played just before. So in this case, this is a minor chord. We're just gonna transpose it up so that the top note of that chord is going to match that note. Because if you really listen to a chord progression, your ear is listening to the top note of the chords most of the time. You're listening to the top note of a chord. So what we can do is we can work backwards to harmonize something out. And the question is it going to be a major chord or a minor chord? For the most part. See how that just sounds off? You're like, that doesn't sound right. So what we do is we simply, if it's a minor chord, we transpose it up to major. If it's a major, vice versa. So in this case, this is a minor ninth chord. We're going to take the third and the seventh, and we're going to hit shift up in FL. And you could even see now they're matching the notes before it. That's because this is the proper chord per the scale. We don't need to get into music theory land. But again, you're either going to have a major chord for the most part or a minor chord. The chances of it being in some other type of chord are very slim. So my ear liked that. Now, if you want more tension, here's where we can start using more advanced chord codes. So let's say you want to have, to be quicker about it, I'll use the stamp because I don't have my chord code chart loaded up. But if you want the chord code chart for free, for anybody watching the replay, just go to busyworksbeats.com/musictheory because I have what's called a chord code chart. And inside the chord code chart, I would pull it up. I'm trying to debate, should I pull it up here so you can screenshot it? Nah, I gotta make you go to busyworksbeats.com/musictheory. But there's a free chord code chart, okay, that you can download straight to your phone. And basically it has all these chord types on it. You know, minor chords, minor seventh, minor ninth, you know, minor 11th, you know, major, and on and on and on. It has Augmented chords, diminished chords. Trying to think what else is on there. Augmented chords, dominant chords. So I go through all these chord types, and what you could do is, I'm trying to give you a lot of knowledge in a short amount of time, but basically there are four chord types. You have the primary chord type, which is your major minor. Then you have more lush chord types, like your sevenths through elevenths and on and on. Then you have, I call turnaround chords. So these chords are used specifically to take listeners out of the song and then pull them back in. So this is what we're going to use today, is a turnaround chord. Now, turnaround chords are going to be your augmented, your diminished chords, your dominant chords. Those are turnaround chords. I can get into the science about it, but it just will take too long. But basically, we're going out of scale on purpose to then pull people back into the scale. So let's transpose this to where, let me see, I'm trying to think, what chord type do I want? So the first one I like is an augmented seventh chord. So to save time, we're going to use chord stamps. We're going to go to the advanced tab and look for where it says augmented. Now that I'm using augmented seventh in my head, they might have a different name for it. But the chord code would be 048. And then let's count it out. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Now right here, we're going to take this up one to 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Let's hear what this sounds like. See how it adds that tension? The reason it adds tension is because these notes are right next to each other. Whenever you have notes right next to each other or a whole step away, meaning two notes away, you create tension. What do you mean snap the grid? You mean tempo? Tempo for hard trap? I don't know. Let the chat. What BPM for hard trap? I'll let the chat help you. Because that's, again, you're taking us on side missions here. I appreciate you, but that's a side mission. I would say trap in general is usually anything above 120 BPM is trap. All the way up to 180 is about the range. It's a very wide range. It's not the tempo, it's how you program the drums in halftime. In double time, technically. So, never mind. Like, for example, when the metronome hits, I don't put the snare on the 2. I don't go 1, 2, 3, 4. I don't do that. I put the snare on the 3 and the 7 count. So that's what makes something trap, is you're putting the snare on the 3 count of the metronome and the 7. So it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, like that. It's not 1, 2, 3, 4. It's not like that. So we have all those courses. Just go to BusyWorks. Go to premium.busyworksbeats.com. I have much more teaching on that there. I just don't have time to go over right now. So I think it could use a little more tricks. So one of the tricks, again, is we're going to keep A sharp as our top note. Now, here's a little complexity to it. We're going to, this is really high level thinking, but basically we're going to assume that we're doing the same voicing trick, which is to pull up the third. So remember, our ear assumes that the top note of the chord progression is the top note of a chord, but that's not always the case. So let's pull this down an octave and let's build a chord around A sharp, and then we're going to transpose it back up. So this is really advanced what I'm doing right now. So I'm assuming that A sharp is the third. Okay, now I'm building a chord around it. So in this case, we're going to have it 0, 1, 2, 3. And then let's just do the same chord type, which is the augmented. So it's 0, 4. So it's 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, I think we had. And then it was 14, 12, 13, 14. Okay, now we need to pull this note back up, control up. Let's hear the voicing. It may or may not sound good. It's a little too dense. Let's pull the G sharp. I like this voicing better. So sometimes, again, it's about frequency. Sometimes it's too much frequency clutter. So voicing is, I can make a whole course on voicing alone. One of these notes, I want to say it's the F. No. I think the fact that it's augmented. So there's different chord types. You have augmented, you have suspended chords, you have diminished chords. It's another one. Ascending keys is here. What's up? Into teaching the masses. Thank you, thank you. Sometimes I'm like, I want to teach something, but then I realize it's going to take 50 minutes to go through it. Then I have to, I'll like start it and then I'll pull back. So if you guys see me looking around, it's because I realize I was getting into something that's super deep to explain. Okay, so this is. Okay, so another chord type you could use, let's just assume it's a regular voicing because that advanced stuff makes it complicated. You could also try diminished. So again, let's just use chord stamps to keep it super simple. Chord stamps, and then we want a diminished chord. Do they have it in here? Where is it at? They only have diminished regular. Okay. Well, the trick to diminished chords is you just count in threes. So it's just 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. Just count in threes. 1, 2, 3. See how it just takes us away? What's up, T-Dot? I like that the best. I also like augmented, but so we can go through it. If you're doing more guitar-based work, usually they do dominant seventh turnarounds because the voicing is different. And it's just a different instrument. So that's usually what they use in guitar more so, dominant sevenths. Okay, so now we have the chords. Let's start adding other instruments. Now we're gonna get into sound selection and focus on the scale. We're in C minor. So really, it's just going up and down the scale. I think people tend to make melody complicated because they're not starting with their brain. So all I'm doing is literally going up note by note. And it just sounds, fits in. So this is more improv than it is a melody. Try to play fast, that's what I get. So I'm just gonna copy that riff. I was trying to play it fast, I was gonna go. But I played the wrong note. So in melody, you have another thing called motifs. So motifs are little phrases that you can clone. They're basically shapes that you clone over. Take the third from the top. Take the third note from top and move it down a note. Take the third note from the top. Are you talking about? I don't know what you're talking about. The third note from the top. 1, 2, 3. Oh, you're giving a suggestion that you're saying? It didn't have the right dissonance for me. Oh, I'm lost. But shout out to you for paying attention. Yeah, I don't want to get too like gospel-y on folks because then we're getting in the weeds. Because then they don't know about scales. And they're like, oh, wait, we can leave a scale? And then it becomes confusing to them because they don't know how to start. So I don't want to get too off in the weeds. So I'm just going to crank this up. So again, my point is the main melody is the vocal. That should come from your brain, okay? Then the harmony is second. And then we're adding little motif stuff on top. So this is like embellishing stuff on top. Okay, so let's see what else we got. So again, I'm treating this more like an improv. Okay, so something I learned from a master, it's actually his birthday today, Travis Marsh. He's a master. I think he plays 50 instruments or something wild, or 12 instruments he's mastered. He has so many instruments. Appreciate you, DJ Wraith. So the one thing I learned from him is that sometimes melody isn't a note, it's rhythm. Okay, so the same way I was talking about earlier, how Jason Joshua pushes sound to the back using the reverb technique. He also, in that video, he was using a volume automation. This is one of the keys in mixing that people don't use, is a volume automation, that pumping effect. It's very subtle, but people don't utilize it enough. So the same thing with melody is sometimes we need a rhythmic thing. So for example, let me just switch the instrument And I'm going to do this for all the new folks. If you're one of the people who already saw this, don't tell them what it is. Okay, so I'm going to play a tune, and you're going to know what it is based on how I play it. You don't even need to change up the notes. You know that that's the Happy Birthday song. Okay, so it's not about the notes sometimes. It's about the rhythm, the timing that you play. That's why motifs are part of melody. It's a time stamp. You know, this do 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 do. Okay, that's a time stamp. I could play it in a different section. So it's not the notes. It's the way, it's the timing. Okay, so that's something that I had to understand later in my years of music theory. Star Wars. So sometimes you can play the same note. Like you'll be taken aback when you realize a lot of melody is just people singing the same note or playing the same note on guitar. And then it's just played. It's picked at a certain rhythm. They're not playing a different note. It's just, you know, it's like that, or they'll just play the same chord, but just strum it out in different timing. So timing is the secret to melodies that people just overlook completely. Excuse me, rhythm, I should say, is the secret to melody. Okay, let's make this a little darker. So let's start adding some edge. So here's where sound selection comes into play. We're gonna pick sounds with more harmonic content that are a little more aggressive. The more harmonic content usually means the more aggression a sound has. So let's go to lead, let's go to bass. This one's cool. So for bass, I'll show you a couple techniques. Again, these aren't, you don't have to use them all the time. Okay, so I'm gonna do more of like a Payroll Giovanni type, Larry June type bass on this. My vibe is in that vibe, so. And then I'll break down what we're doing. So all I'm doing really is using the octave. I'm using the same note, up an octave. Then coming back down. I forgot what I just played, but. We could always retrieve it in FL if I have to go back. Nah, it's not the same timing. So let's say you play something dope. Go to Tools. Go to Dump Score Log into Pattern. And then go to... Oh, I think I did the wrong one. So go to Tools. I think I clicked the wrong button. Go to Dump Score Log. Go to Last 2 Minutes. Merge. I don't know the difference between merge and replace. Okay, so now we'll map out everything you just played, even if you didn't hit record. What is it? Oh. Let me find where it is, though. Okay, so you just got to look for the MIDI, which is not the easiest thing to find. So give me a second. Where are my notes? Hold up, y'all. I lost my notes. I see a pocket of notes. So this is not the easiest thing to do. Give me a second. Where are the notes? Okay, here we go. No, it's not it. Oh, I'm on the wrong thing, that's why. Okay. All right. Okay, so here we go. Here are the notes. Okay, so let's say you played something and you lost it. And you liked it, but you didn't save it. So you can go back in your score log, and it will keep whatever you just played. So let's go to pattern mode. I think it's this one. Is that it? No, it's this one over here. So we'll fix the timing. So don't worry about that. Just go to a new pattern, and then paste that in. Your piano roll, you got to go to piano roll view first to paste. If you copy from the piano roll, you have to paste it in the piano roll view. Just left click and drag it to the edge, and then we can fix the timing. Yeah, I know that struggle. Oh, you said Wraith is on it. He's just being, hold on. Now I agree. I wanted this one. I play kind of sloppy. Okay, so I'm going to line this up while you, I'm just going to let you listen while I do it. But this is technically, I'm just lining it up. Let's go to song mode. It definitely wasn't that early, so let's pull it. Darn, I don't remember the timing. Maybe it was that timing. Okay, we're going to highlight these, hit Alt-Q. Control-Q does a harder snap, and it snaps to your grid value. Alt-Q is a lighter snap. It doesn't note correct that harshly. Thank you. It's a little sloppy, so I'm just going to fix it. Okay. Yeah. You are silly, man. I just like the. So here's another. I'm kind of jumping all over the place. Let's just break down the bass and then I'll explain what we're doing. So, bass, you can get away with bass when you're playing your octaves, which is the same note up an octave. Even if you're doing 808s, these rules apply. Or you could do what's called a fourth. So fourths are five semitones up from your root note. So if you go your root note, just count up five. One, two, three, four, five. It's F in this case. So I can do, like if you don't know what to play with bass, you could at least do octaves, which is one note, then the octave above. And then you could spice it up with the fourth. Just play those notes. Also, you could do perfect fifth. A perfect fifth is seven semitones up from the root note. So if you're starting at C, it's one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, you land at G. Okay, so you can use all those notes to kind of start you off if you don't know how to start your bass lines. You could just use the fourth, the octaves, the perfect fourth, and the perfect fifth. To add notes if you don't know how to spice up your bass. Also at the end, with bass, you can do cool things like turnarounds. This is taken from gospel, blues, and funk. Turnarounds are, or let's call it like a step down bass in this case. We're just going note by note down. So it's, instead of playing the notes in the scale, you're just going note by note, semitone, I'm trying to use other words people know. Half step based. So normally I wouldn't play this for the scale because the scale is. But instead I'm gonna walk the bass down note by note. This note's out of the key. So introduce those if you wanna spice up your turnarounds for your bass. And that's what created this nice turnaround sound. So I'm just gonna copy that bass over. Bass is pretty simple. I mean, it's really that simple for the most part. Let me copy this over. I think I duplicated. I think there's two notes on each of these. Yeah, I did. Whoops. FL should tell us if we have two notes stacked up on each other. That's one thing that needs to be changed. Okay, let's pull this over. Let me fix these. Something's wrong with the glide here. Should be maybe because these are overlapping. FL doesn't really tell us. It just makes it a little bit brighter, but it allows us to overlap notes. I think because if you do multiple takes and you overdub, technically you have two of the same note. Getting into the weeds about that though. So the song's done, it just needs drums. So notice I'm doing drums last. We did all the music theory first, now we're doing last. So again, to start back from square one, we started with a vocal melody. C minors, what I put the key in. I used scalar to figure out what key I wanted to be in. I ran my vocals through effects so that I can hear the final result about how much room a vocal would take up in a normal recording. A lot of people, they record these thin vocals, they build a beat around it, but like real vocals have a lot of effects on it. Okay, so vocals take up a lot of space. And then once we had the vocal melody, again, singing from your actual brain into the computer or into your smartphone, imported into your DAW, and then you could run it through AutoTune or all the stuff that I did. Then we mapped out the scale, which was C minor, and then I harmonized the vocal with the chords with a soft instrument that could go brighter over time. 3X OSC, Travis Scott bass. I went with Larry June on this one. I think maybe because the chords influenced me. Okay, and then we have, once you have the chord harmonization, then I added the improv type sound over it, which again is coming down to motifs and then rhythm. Like it's about rhythm sometimes with melodies. It's not always the notes you use. Rhythm. Okay, motif and rhythm. And then lastly, we have the bass underneath. Let me see if we pull this bass down an octave to just have the same vibe. Gritty. Okay, so now let's go into the drums. Drag audio from Edison piano roll. It always, when you do the audio from or MIDI to audio to MIDI function. Okay, now we're going to use some decap drums, and now we're going to, I'll show you how you create the groove with the music. Your drums fit into the groove of the music or accent it, and then even if it doesn't, I'll show you ways where you can go back and make the drums override the groove or the movement of the track. If the music is too elongated, it's called. No, I didn't go to school for any of this. I had to learn. There was nobody at the time teaching this stuff on YouTube. I was one of the first people to teach music production stuff on YouTube. Me and NFX Beats from War Beats. And like, I forget the other guy, but there's like one other guy, I forget his name. But he had Reason, so it was super hard to learn because he was teaching on Reason and he was like a really good musician and it was like really hard to learn. So let's grab, now everybody does tutorials, which is good. Because it encourages more people to get into it. Okay, so let's open these up. This is Decap's Drums That Knock X or 10. He sent these over to me. So I want to use him because his mixing skills are crazy. On the snares, for example, they're so clean. I don't know what he runs them through to get them so like sheen sounding. Sounds like they're going through like a sheet, silk sheet, but he figured it out. So let's find a snare that matches the tone. This can match. I like this one too. So note, okay, so hopefully you're seeing all the steps. I'm going through this drums to match the music. So this is why the drums are coming later in the process. If you start with drums, your kick and your snare have to match the tone. Decap, you don't know Decap? Decap is the guy, that's Decap. He's the one who debunked, like if FL 11 sounds different than FL 20, and he debunked if FL sounds different than Ableton. He proved that they're all the same. And he showed why people have those perceptions. And then he proved why the PC version of FL sounds different than the Mac version. It's because of like some clipper that's in the settings. But you can turn it off for the PC. Yeah, nowadays, there's a video by, what's his name? Valuetainment. And it goes over like the scam of college. It's recent. Like it just came out like a day ago or 3 days ago. You should go watch it. It's very informative. Valuetainment. I forget what it's called. It's called like college something. Okay, so let's start drawing these drums. Now the drums are going to be more like quantized. So if we're going quantized, we don't have to play them by hand unless you need to do it. I think it's called, yeah, college, something like that. Oh, you're saying, I get the joke. Okay, so let's add our drums. We have a kick, hi-hat, and a snare. We just got to find a kick. Oh no, DJ Wraith, I'm sure you're gonna figure out a good use to it. Okay, so you want something that fits the vibe. That's why I'm previewing the sounds as I'm listening to the music, not separately. Okay, because not all drums match. You said Mac doesn't slow down? Yeah, I like the Mac. It's hard to go from Mac to PC laptops. Once you're on Mac, you just kind of like become a Mac fan. Okay, so what we're going to do for the hi-hats is we're going to do something pretty simple. We're going to right-click and then fill each two steps. That's the typical thing we do in trap. Now, you guys have seen trap drums a million times over, so I'm going to show people who don't know. So that's why I said earlier, you put the snare on the 3 and the 7 count. So turn your metronome on and just count. One, let me turn the hi-hats off. So it's 1, 2, 3, 4. So let's put the snare right here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 1, 2, 3, 4. So the snare goes on the 3 and the 7 count. I'm going to swap the snare. Once you go back, you never go back. Let's add the kick in here. So more bouncy kicks have more frequent kicks. So it's boom, 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 boom. That's the bouncy kicks. So you can see the song is forming now. Now it's just a matter of you can switch up your drums. I'm just trying to keep it simple for live. So at this point, you need a level. So let's start turning stuff down. So what people don't want to do is turn the drums down, but we're actually going to turn the drums down. You're going to feel a little more back and forth in this, and then you pull your stuff up based on the priority of the sound. So I need my snare to hit and the kick. Now you have a lot more in-between space, they call a groove. Now, this is more smooth, but if you guys are going for that hard sound, you can run it through a Fruity Soft Clipper, turn your threshold up, and then just turn your stuff up going into the Fruity Soft Clipper. What I would recommend is you turn your stuff down, getting tongue twisted, down in the mixer, and then open up a Fruity Balance, which is basically a gain knob or volume knob, and you can crank the volume going into the Soft Clipper, but on the master track. You don't use the metronome so much. So now you're pushing the entire track as opposed to cranking everything into the clipper. Now you have the priority of the kick being the loudest, the snare being the loudest, and the vocal, and then all that's being driven at that ratio through the clipper. So you're gonna get a different sound. Now, a quick, easy way to level is if you turn up your headphones all the way, not all the way, louder, I should say, and then stuff's just going to sound louder, and you're going to naturally want to turn it down. So I'm going to do that right now. Okay, so I got a pretty good balance to begin with, so I didn't need to touch it much. The vocal was a little... I printed it with reverb, so there's no way to undo reverb on a vocal once it's in the hard-boiled recording. So that's the only thing I would adjust. But to fix it quickly, this is advanced. We would use an EQ. Let's do ozone EQ, and then we would go to the sides, which is where all the stuff that's hard to handle is usually, on the sides of the stereo. And I'm going to solo my vocal real quick. Now, this is usually where a lot of that unwanted frequency builds up is on the sides. So you can see a lot of the low frequency I don't necessarily want. So I'm going to actually get rid of this using a high pass. Get rid of this. Now keep in mind, this does affect your stereo imaging because now it becomes smaller technically. But now it's less muddy on the sides. There's less low frequency information on the sides. So I didn't get rid of the reverb, but at least tamed that area that I was focused on. And again, we're running it through harsh compression, which is not my chain. Okay, so let's run it through the balance and then crank it into the clipper if you want more of an edgy sound. Pull back some of that clipping, you lose some of the punch on the kick. Now you could do this specifically to the kick, you don't have to do it to everything if you want to keep a cleaner tone. But I like everything to have like a cohesive saturation type vibe. So all I'm doing now is adding EQ to the bass, and you can emphasize some frequencies. Let's emphasize 60 or 70. Make it more round in the bottom. That's how you make a beat using music theory. Now, we took this long because I broke down every single thing about it. But once you have that kind of process in your mind, it makes making beats so much easier. You start with the key, you move to the chords, you do your melody, you do your bass, you do your vocal melody, assuming that you didn't already start with the melody, and then you do your drums, and then you mix. So if you follow that process, I'll type it in the chat because that was a lot. That was kind of fast. You start with your scale. Your scale slash BPM. Then you move to your chords. Do I have a button? Yeah, I do. Then you move to your chords. Then you go to your melody. Then you move to your bass. Then you add drums. Then vocal melody. Mixing. And then mastering after mixing. Which most of us do all in one fell swoop anyway. So that's the process of, if you want a song every time, just follow that process. It makes everything more streamlined. And a lot of amateurs, they get stuck and they get beat blocked because they keep going back and forth between all these phases. They'll go back and change something, which changes the whole chain of effect. Like if you really think about this logically, like a logic tree, like those things where you call of, you know, 1-800-COMCAST, you know, and then you go through the options. Press 1 to talk to billing. Press 2 to cancel your internet. Which you would never do. Press 3 to, you know, whatever Comcast does. Okay, so there's a logical process. And if you really get down to the root of it, you can't really pick chords unless you have a key or a tonal center called the scale. You can't truly build a melody. You can, but I'll say in its fullest form, you usually get inspired to create a melody from the chords because that's the foundational harmonization underneath something, and you sing on top. That's why singers, even if you play some guitar chords, they'll just start singing. It's because their brain is creating melody using the chords as like a foundational thing, musical foundation. So even melody requires harmonization of chords. Then bass usually comes from the melody because you're taking the melody and just dropping it down a couple octaves. And that's basically what the bass is, a support for the melody. And the drums are going to be a result of the groove you create from the music in hip hop most of the time. So that's why the drums kind of rely on the music. Again, there's ways to mix and match this stuff. And then the vocal melody comes after all this stuff because you need a beat to record on. And then mixing comes after the vocal melodic process because you need to have all the elements there to mix them. So there's a logical reason why that process works. It goes back to a logic tree of thought. And I mapped it out for you. As a quick template. As I play my song to yours, they sound alike, though. Is it raining right now? Can't tell. Is it? It's overcast, and I can't tell if it's raining or not. Okay, so now that you guys kind of saw the whole process of songwriting, again, for all the loyal folks who have been here, thank you. And all the people who are new, who just, they're like blown away by this information. We have free courses, so if you really want to get geeky and go deep with it and make the beats that are in your mind, I have a website where you can learn for free. Just go to premium.busyworksbeats.com. Click here for free music production courses. I think we had like 300 people sign up in the last day or two or something like that. So a lot of people are grabbing these, okay? So there's a lot of free stuff for you. What was I going to tell you? Pardon me. What was I going to say? oh, if you guys want to go in depth and create different projects, like for example, maybe you're like, I want to make Lil Uzi type beats. We'll guide you through the process of making a Lil Uzi type beat. Not everybody wants to make a Lil Uzi. So let's say you just want to learn how to play your keyboard better and play stuff like this. Now, I'm not a piano player, I'm a producer. That's why this thing's titled How to Music Theory for Producers, because I don't, you know, I'm not going to sit here for 10 years and practice scales. That's just not, I don't have enough time. Ooh. Do that again, because I hit that sour note. Hold up. I can't go out like that. There we go. Rosé, huh? Then you got F minor. So there's a lot of chords I could show off with. Oh, I gotta show this one chord, hold on. That's my favorite chord of all time. This chord right here. This rhyme right here. Craziest chord I've ever heard in my life. And I did it by accident one day. Okay, so if you wanna learn that, just music theory that can apply to any DAW, we have courses on that. Music theory in a day is the one I would recommend you get started with. And then from there, you would move into chord magic is the next, and then melody magic would be after that. And then we have something called the music theory essentials at our site. So if you're just trying to learn music theory, we have that stuff. If you're trying to learn beat making, we have that stuff as well. You can learn sample beats. Let me go through the website. Why am I sitting here describing it? I could show you on the website. My brain didn't even think to go to the actual website. I'm using my hands to illustrate like an idiot. Okay, so here's the website. Here's what it looks like. You could join for free. You could join for the paid. You can cancel it anytime. It just requires email and the team. Right now, we have 150 emails on backlog. So if you emailed in the last couple days or so, we have 150 emails to go clear out. So that's going to take a little bit. But we have thousands of people who signed up already. So again, there's free courses right here, Drake Melodies. Mastering, beat mixing. This is the free stuff. Trap series, melody series, sample series, piano melodies, trap melodies. If you guys want to learn UK drill, we got that. Mastering for beat makers, beat battle course, sound design, which I went in. I showed you how to create drum kits. What else do we do? Like the essentials of sound design, basically. This is actually, I'm surprised I gave that one away for free. I just wanted you to see what's on the other side. And then the social media masterclass. So that's the free stuff. And then if you want to go paid, it's called Premium Deluxe. This is literally every course I've ever created all in one. So I think there's a total of 53 courses in here. And you could pay one time, you could pay for the lifetime access and it's in installments. So you can pay $49.99 over 10 installments. If you don't know what installments means, if you're younger, it basically means you get to pay per month for a certain amount of time. So in this case, it's split up into 10 payments of $49.99, but you'll have access for a lifetime. So it's not going to be monthly forever and ever. So that's the offer we've added. This is our Premium Deluxe. And again, it has every single course in here. I'm just going to show you a quick list just so you can see it on the screen. So it's FL Studio course in here. We have Beat Magic, which is for beat makers specifically. Melody Magic, more of our, if you just want to learn music theory. Modern Melody, which is like an extension of Melody Magic. Music Theory in a Day, I would recommend for everybody. Music Theory Essentials is like an addition to. Mix Bonus is our newer mix course for beat makers specifically. I show people how to mix literally in 15 minutes. It's pretty insane. In fact, let me open up a video because I could show you because I have access. So let me show you just the craziness. And if you ever want to know what's in a course, you can click inside the course and it has the curriculum laid out, like every single video that's in the course. So I literally show you gain staging, hard drums, leveling. But the cool part is that I show you how to mix in 15 minutes, which is pretty wild. So let me just show you real quick. And this is using headphones. I didn't mix over the speakers.
All right, either. We should be rocking.
Okay, that was back when I was in the studio too. So you got the good acoustics. Okay, so I made this when I was in the studio, my commercial studio. Where is it at? Mixing in 15 minutes. Here we go.
Hello and welcome to BusyWorks Beats.
I sounded depressed back then.
.com. This is
I'm like, hello and welcome to BusyWorks Beats. Beats. I must have been going through it.
Mix Genius, and I'm going to...
Dag, I just sound like depressed animal. Okay, so here's what it sounds like, though.
And then we boost... I left the negative point.
Hold up. Did I play the track?
In staging.
Dag, I must have been going... I must have been sad. I sound sad in this video. You see what I got to muscle through as a content creator? I got to muscle through sadness, hard times, keep a smile on my face. Y'all would never know.
And filter to...
Dag, I sound down and out. Because that's the beat we're mixing. But I show you literally how to mix in 15 minutes. It's pretty wild. Okay. So there's a lot of courses in here. I'm not trying to belabor the point about premium. I just want you to understand what's on the other side. Like, there's a gazillion courses in here. Your game needs a hug. I filmed that back. That had to be last year, I think. Or was that? Yeah, it was definitely last year. Probably around, dang, I don't know when I filmed that. That was a long time ago, though. Like last year, April, maybe. Okay, so Mix Genius is learning how to mix in 15 minutes for beat makers. Mastering, again, you already saw that. Vocal mixing course. I need to update this one because there's a lot I've learned since then. And I need to show you guys what I've learned since then. So again, you can go through the whole list. I'm not going to sit here and read everything. Songwriting secrets, literally from Mike Caron and Atlantic Records. I figured out their formula. I need to add to that too because I have some stuff I learned since. So I'm going to update all this premium stuff with all the new knowledge that I have. But basically anything you could think of is in here. The only things I don't really cover are pop music and EDM. I don't cover those like that. So if you want to learn that, you could let me know, but I just don't cover that stuff. So that's that. And what else don't I cover? I don't cover country either, but you could use the theory though. Because people are like, do I have to make hip hop beats? It's like, nah, you could just learn, you know, the minor chords, major chords. Okay, so I'll leave it up to the chat where we go from here. So which topic should we cover next? And I'm only letting you decide because we've gone through the foundation about everything. Should we do chords, melody, sound? I'm trying to think, what else would we do? Just beat making in general? Or mixing, I guess. I'll let you vote. You get to determine how this course shows up in our premium. This video replay will be added to our premium side. So I'm going to leave it up on YouTube for like a couple days so you can rewatch it, but then I'm going to pull it over to our premium side after about like 5 days or 3 days. So you get time to rewatch it. And it'll be for free on our premium. I'm just going to pull it off the YouTube platform though. Because I'll be giving away everything and I can't keep giving away everything. Click here for EDM. We need LiPo. I got to interview LiPo. And who else killed us with the EDM yesterday in the beat battle? It was LiPo from weeks ago. And then somebody hit us with EDM yesterday during our beat battle. It was pretty wild. Boom, bat. Mm-hmm. All right, so we got beat making. You said, just want to say thank you for all the information. Thank you. Creative processes. Do you play with it? So do you play it without the vocal? Oh, play it without the vocal. Yeah. Larry June sound with the chorus on the piano. bass. That's the beat by itself. Let me take out the kick and the bass. But yeah, it's all about that chorus on that piano. So you were saying pads. The beat you just made, do you play it without the vocal harmony? You don't have to have harmony on the vocals all the time. Again, the more notes you add, usually makes it softer. So whenever you're harmonizing, something usually gets softer, not more dark. I think it's storming outside, so I might have to make the next one shorter. Automation, delay and reverb techniques. I'm trying to quickly read your chat. Yeah, these, when you have clean sounds, they don't need to be mixed. But you have to start with clean sounds. Most people don't. How you doing? Excuse, I have a question concerning automation. Is the shortcut to bring it to zero when working? So if you have automation, what I like to do, there's no shortcut that I know of. You could just hit Control Z if you mess up. But let's say you want to automate something real quick. You right click, create automation clip. First thing I do when I automate is I right click the first value and I copy it. Just in the case that I click and I forget, you know, where I started. So that's a habit that you want to get in the habit of doing, is copying that initial value. In the case that you screw up and you click down here and then you delete this and you move it and you forgot where you started from, that's just a good habit. And you could hit Control Z to undo, or Control Alt Z to go further back in the case that you want to get rid of steps. That's what I do for automation. There's probably a shortcut, but that's what I do. Let me see. This may or may not work. But usually, hold up, let me see something. I doubt this is gonna work. But I'm just, no, yeah, that would be a different function. I thought the, nah, never mind. I don't even wanna tell you because it might mess you up. But in the piano roll, if you have a velocity that's not back to normal, like let's say you played it by hand, but you don't like the up and down velocity of it, you could go to your hi-hats, for example, go to piano roll. And let's say your hi-hats look like this, like you played it by hand, so it just looks like this, all scrambled up. What you could do in FL that I love is you can hit Alt and then left click and it will reset the velocity back to its normal velocity. That's something that I don't know how to do in Ableton yet. LiPo interview. We just gotta watch his live stream while we're live streaming, just Inception. Yeah, I saw that collab you guys had from a while ago. How you doing? So yes. All right, so let's see what the vote read beat making. Okay, but what about beat making? You know? Oh, you said melody was second and then mixing. Okay, so let's just start a new beat and I'll focus on the melody and the beat. All right, check. Hold up. All right, so you said focus on sound selection and timing, automation. It's kind of boring because I don't use automation a lot. Like even if I'm playing a real keyboard, I'm not twisting the knobs and doing all this stuff to it. Like sometimes automation isn't needed. I think people force stuff because they don't know like how to make their song sound bigger. So they just do whatever feature is on their computer. Pretty good. I think I'm nice with it. I would play the other track without the, let me do that. Let me play the other track that I just made without the vocals on it. Cause it's a pretty hard track. And I didn't realize when I rendered it to YouTube video format, I lowered the audio quality. So it just sounds super small. The bass doesn't even feel like the bass. So I'm going to go back and re-render it potentially. But yeah, let me play it without the vocals on it. Hold up. Where'd I put it? Album. Here. No, it's not where I put it. Here. Mix 3. Look at how many saves. This is one song. I saved this song. Let me see how many times. Oh, it doesn't say. I saved this song a lot of times. Let's just say 50 times. This song has 50 versions of itself. All right, this track is like a gazillion tracks on it. So let me turn some stuff off. Okay, so I'll explain a couple things. Now I'm hearing delay, so it's hard to hear myself. What was I gonna tell y'all? So this beat, let me mute all the vocals. I don't even remember what's what. There's so many tracks on here. Okay, what was I gonna tell y'all about this beat? The beat doesn't have a gazillion things going on. The main thing is what did I do? Let's see. Let's zoom out. Let's see what I did. So the main thing I did with this is the bass changes. So it goes from like wah, 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 and then it goes into a distorted bass where it's like zzz, zzz. You know, it's the only difference is the harmonics of the bass. And I just repeated, you guys saw me make this in a tutorial recently, the drill beat tutorial. I went through and I showed you how I recorded vocals and made a choir sound. I'm not going to redo that now. And the main thing too about this beat is the crowd effects that are underneath the beat. So it makes the beat sound much more hype. But the only difference in this beat, the only change up, the real change up is in the bass, which is the audio format right here. So it goes from more of a smooth bass to like a distorted bass. That's literally the only main change that we added. Let me see. I can't even hear myself. Hold on. Check, 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 check. Okay, so I'll play with the mastering on.
I done made a million off the stove. I done went the wall. How you gon' run up on the plug? We did this before. I done made a million.
Okay, so I just wanted to show you a little bit about what made that song sound good. It's just the idea was good. So it didn't need 1,000 automations, 1,000 changes. It was just a good idea. So the main difference, though, is that bass. And it goes from... Then it goes into... And I showed you how to do this in the actual tutorial. Because we had to print it to audio. So what else did I do? And then the crowd effects make this sound way more hype. If I take out the crowd effects, let me see what this sounds like. Sounds super empty. Okay, so the crowd noise, yeah, the scream I just randomly dragged in from the Lunch 77 kit, the crowd noise is adding noise to the background. So sometimes noise, we think of noise as like this random thing that we would never use, but noise fills out the gaps and it adds energy. So sometimes you just need a noisy thing in your beat to amp up the energy. That's why sawtooth waves are more energetically rich because they have a lot of frequency content. So that crowd, once you take the crowd out, the beat is not the same. So that's a huge part to this beat. And then the distortion on the bass is also a huge part. Yeah, but you guys saw that tutorial, so I'm not gonna go over that, but let's create a new track. All right, check. I can't hear myself. Okay, here we go. Pull us back to 128. There we go. Bang, bang, boom. Okay, so let's focus on what you need help with, which is, you said sound selection. I need to make more. We have templates, but they're in our ultimate producer bundle, but they're not for the modern songs. They're for like Gunna, I think was our last. It's called the ultimate producer bundle, but I need to make more. And these templates, so I don't know if you're asking about FL Studio templates where it's only FL Studio plugins, or if you mean templates with third-party plugins. The reason I don't use templates with third-party plugins a lot is because people don't have the plugins, and then they have to spend more money to buy the plugin. So it's pointless having a template, unless it's like custom-made. All right, so that's why I don't do it as much. Let me save this real quick, and then we'll go over different aspects that you want to go over. So let's go to sort. Or no, where did I save this? Tutorial. Okay, and then we'll break it down. Okay, so I saw in the chat you said sound selection. Sounds and where it should be. I'm assuming you mean like how to mix it or pan it. Again, you shouldn't have to do a lot of this stuff though. What else? Timing, automation. So let's start with automation, because I think, again, it's overly used. I just think people, you don't need as much automation, more for EDM than hip hop. I know, I kind of want one. You got the MPC Live, you're like, never turning back to FL or whatever you were on before. Okay, so let's start off with automation. I'm trying to think of a plugin I can pull up. Let's do Serum, because it's pretty simple. So again, automation is the ability of turning something, like, best way to use the drip plugin. So if there's something you want to change in a plugin or a sound, that's what automation is for. It's for turning stuff up and down. Because in real life, you have knobs on your synthesizer. So when you're playing on your synthesizer, you can move the knob. Most people move the cutoff knob. So for example, they'll do this. They'll play a chord. And then they'll move this knob as they're playing it. So they'll do. And they'll do this with their hand. So the problem with the computer is you can't twist these virtual knobs. So you have to create what's called automation. Now that's why a lot of MIDI controllers were made, so that you can link your MIDI controller to that specific knob. Now this one, this FL Key 37, I don't know why it doesn't link to stuff in the DAW. Like stuff in the plugin, I mean. I don't know why it doesn't do it. Let's try it now. So I'll move this cutoff knob and then I'll go to the drop down. The way you would do it, you go to browse parameter and then you see which thing you just moved. So I just moved the cutoff. Is it even on here? Oh yeah. Okay. So it should highlight whatever you're moving. It should highlight. So if I highlight the resonance, it's going to highlight that file. If I highlight the cutoff, it changes. If I move the unison detune, it highlights that knob. So it's showing you what you're moving. Okay. I mean, it links the parameter to what you're moving. Put it that way. So to link this stuff, go to your drop down. I was making sure that it linked. So it does have the link. We need to go to link our parameter. Okay. And then we need to move whatever thing that we're trying to control it with. Now it doesn't work. I don't know why this doesn't work. Let me check my MIDI settings before I say it doesn't work. Because I think there's a MIDI... MIDI out, then we have DAW out. But normally if you move a knob that's a MIDI controller, it will link that knob. As long as you have auto detect on, it will link that specific knob to that specific thing. So on this FL Key 37, it's not doing that, and I don't know why. Maybe it's the port. Maybe that's why. No, MIDI port 0. I'm gonna figure this out one day. So this isn't doing what I expected to do. So again, I don't know why that's not working. So let's just use the mod wheel, because the mod wheel works. Okay, and let's hit accept. Let me do this again. I screwed that up. Move the knob, go to the drop down, go to link, and then I'm gonna hit the mod wheel. It says volume. That's not even what, again, FL Key 37 for you. Octave, what, semitone, what is going on? We just linked that to the volume some type of way. I have no idea what I just did. That's what I get for touching stuff. Darn it. I don't know how to unlink it either, so we got to start a new project. Dag darn it. Hold on. That's what I get for touching stuff. Yeah, so this keyboard is very different than the other keyboards I've used when it comes to automating using these knobs on this keyboard. So I'm going to have to watch a tutorial from FL because they're different because it's linked to your DAW in a different way. But that's how you would do it normally. So let's just say you don't have a controller to begin with. Maybe that's a sign that we need to talk to the people without MIDI controllers. So let's start all over again. Let's do this. Boom, boom. Okay. So again, the point is, in reality, you can twist knobs. If I got up and played my Prophet, I could twist knobs as I'm playing the sound. It creates a unique sound. So we could do the same thing. In the DAW, you have to move whatever you want to modulate. So just move the cutoff knob in this case. We're going to go to the drop-down, browse parameters. It should highlight the name of the parameter. Then we're going to right-click and create an automation clip. Oh, that's what I was trying to do, link to controller. Okay, so create an automation clip. Oh, you know what? I did it. That's why. Okay. Anyway, create an automation clip. And then let's create some notes. So I'm just going to play a chord progression, and we're going to automate the cutoff knob over time. And we're going to get into weird automations you could do as well. So let's do D minor, which you can't hear. I can't hear my... Okay. Then we'll do... Scoop that up. That's all good. Let's quantize these notes. How did I play a different? I don't know how I played a whole different chord. Then I go. Okay, then I'll show you how to make this sound more like a house beat. CG is in the building. Okay, so let's make this more of a house groove. I appreciate you, CG. One of the top dogs. Go follow him for like advice. He just does stuff. All right, so what we're going to do is move this value over time. So again, it's linked. This automation is linked to our cutoff point. So at 100%. It means the filter's open the entire time. Now what we can do is tell the filter to either close or go back up. So the highest point is going to be the open value. Tank is here, what up? And let's do this. Delete this. So now we're telling the cutoff to go down. Okay, so you can, let me go into smaller increments. So here's where I would go into my snap to grid and maybe get into the half beat measure so that it's easier to do cool things. And then we can open it back up. So let's use the metronome to help us. And then we're going to go open again. And then do little envelopes here. Now it's a little tedious drawing on the playlist, but. And then we could. So you're basically controlling the envelope of the filter, but you're doing it manually. You can also program the sound into this, but. Okay, so now we're gonna add ping pong. Okay, so now I'm gonna show you how to modulate other things. So that's just the cutoff, which is the most common thing people use. Even in sound demos, when they show you a new synth, they start with the filter because you can hear the filter. You can't really hear like other things most of the time. Okay, with that being said, I'm going to get a little complex here with the matrix. We're going to go to source, note on alternative, go to destination A. We're going to tell the note panning of A to go left and right based on this amount. So now we're going to get a different voicing. That in itself is an automation. Let's thicken up the sound a little bit. So maybe add four voices. So let's say you want the detune to kind of fluctuate. Let's add an LFO over top the detune and just give it a small range by pulling in the blue thing down. So now it will go through these motions, and this is the analog type sound. You can slow it down. Let's maybe slow it. So now you have a changing pitch. Now I'm going to get a little geeky with y'all. So I'm going to add another oscillator, same LFO, but over top of the fine tune pitch this time, and pull it in a little bit. So this will have its own pitch wobbling effect separate from the detuning effect of A. So this will create like a sloppy pitch sound. Gives you more of an analog sound. Okay, so things we would modulate in this case or automate. Let's see, what can we automate? Maybe delay. Let's turn on delay. And I usually don't like direct effects, but let's automate the delay wet level. So let's just turn that knob. Go to the drop down, go to browse parameters, and it should highlight whatever you just moved. So it says delay wet. So that's the knob, the mix level. Let's right click, create an automation clip. So now we can tell this to come on and off over time. So let's say you want it to exaggerate towards the end, and you want delay, like a heavy delay, and then turn off. So remember this, because this delay is so much to teach you, because this delay is an insert, you're overlapping the original sound. So it actually pushes the original sound back time-wise. So it's not gonna be like the sound and then it echoing. It's gonna be like a blur type sound. Yeah, you could do stuff like that. So you can turn it on and off. So I don't like it in this. I kind of only like it at the end. So let's use it at the end. Let me see what it sounds like right here. Nah, it doesn't sound right. So it really only sounds good at the end. That's why I said I don't add automation where it doesn't need automation. Okay, so you can also automate. I'm trying to think of something crazy we could automate. Maybe, we could do an LFO over, maybe like vibrato, for example. Like if you want to create a vibrato effect that comes in, but only for certain sections, you would add an LFO over top the fine tune. And then you would set this to take it off BPM mode, put it on about 5 hertz or so, or 1 hertz if you want to go slower. Let me turn off oscillator B. So you hear the pitch wobble. Okay, so you want that to come in over time. What you would do is you would take I don't know if we could automate this. How we do this? Is there an on switch? Let me think for a second. LFOs might not have the ability to be turned on and off. What would that be called? I guess what you could do is just automate the range, but this might not be possible. So take this and just drag it and then go to browse parameter. It may or may not. Yes, it's mod for amount. So we're going to right click, create automation clip. So 0 is off and then 100% is on. So again, you could have a sound start off normal and then go into vibrato. So let's turn it off. Sounds like it's on. Yeah, this didn't do what I thought it was going to do. Unless it's opposite day. Hold on, maybe 0 is all the way up. Okay, so this is opposite, which is freaky. Okay, so it's the opposite, so I just did it backwards. You said in the cutoff automation, don't drop it to 0 value. In the what? In the cutoff? Oh, don't drop it to 0 value. Yeah, but it's still on. Like, I'm trying to figure out what the on and off switch is for this LFO. I don't know Serum that well. To that degree, to where I can turn this on and off. Let me do one more thing before I just skip that. It says mod for amount. I just moved this knob. So that's a different value. there's a way, and I forget how to do it, but you can make it unipolar. So that's the part where, you know, it has to be a 50 because I think this is a bipolar setting. Maybe that's why. Okay, so let's start at 50 value. This is so unnecessarily complicated. Okay, that's why it was a bipolar setting. So basically, it can go up and down 100%. So when I had it at 100, it was actually at plus 100. Where I had it at zero, it was at negative 100. So in this case, you have to put it at 50 to be like not on, which is convoluted as crap, and then turn it to whatever direction. And then, yeah, so zero is not zero in this case. That's why. Took me a second, but we figured it out. Okay, so now you can have certain notes be automated. I mean, be a vibrato. Okay, so I'm going to just, again, would I do this? This is pretty tedious, but I mean, some people would probably do vibrato automation. I could see that being a real case. I don't know why it carries on like that. Okay, so you get the gist. We figured it out. My brain was like, there has to be something. Okay, so that's pretty much the gist. And then you would add your house stuff to wrap the groove around it. So if you want, so for certain genres, the groove is created with a filter and not the actual notes that you're playing. You're not playing like dun, 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 dun. It's the actual filter moving that's creating the groove. And it's usually a low pass filter. You can also do volume grooves, but that's not the same thing. So low pass filter is usually how they do it. So I forget who gave us some house drums. Maybe Kashmir has some loops in here. Let's see. Does he not have house in here? Darn it. He has disco loops. Let's use some disco. All right, disco it up. Okay, it's at 100 BPM, so we can slow this bad boy down. 100 BPM. So once you have the automation locked in, now you can go back to the sound and start messing with it. You said mapping the chaos to the coarse pitch, the matrix. Yeah, chaos tends to be like very vibrato-y. I would think it would be random, but it's very like vibrato-y when I use it. The drill tutorial is called, that's a good question. Let me find it real quick. So if you want to make the beat that you guys heard, it says our stream. Okay. If you want to make the drill beat you heard earlier, it is called, probably should go to youtube.com/ BusyWorks Beats. And then it is called, give me 3 seconds to find it. It's called, I think drill, is it, which one is it? Is it drill? I think it's drill beat rhythm. It's one of these, drill melody made easy, or it might be the drill beat rhythm and mixing. I forget which one. It's one of these with the purple thumbnail. That's the where the beat came from. All right, so pick one of those. So now we can, now that we have all this stuff in place, now you can go in and change up the automation to fit your groove of your track. Okay, so what you can do is grab these top points and pull it down so it's not so bright. Okay, so let's add some. What I'm going to do now is add an arpeggio. Now, Serum doesn't, I wish it had a built-in arpeggio function. So what I'm going to do is use Omnisphere and just to draw out the arpeggio, because, you know, Silent is the only other one I could think of that would give me the sound that I'm looking for. So I'm going to copy the chords We're going to paste them in the OmniSphere. We're going to hit Control L to elongate all these notes so that they don't stop. And then we're going to go to arpeggio mode in OmniSphere, go up, and we're going to set this range to 3 octaves. So I'm glad I opened up OmniSphere because I forgot about this. So OmniSphere, if you move a knob, like let's say you turn on your filter and you move the knob and you're trying to automate it, you can't do the same thing, which is go to the drop down and go to browse parameter. It's not going to show up. So in OmniSphere, it's very different. What's up? Oh, faster. Louder. Thank you. So in OmniSphere, what you have to do, if you're wondering why your automation doesn't work, you right click the value or whatever you're trying to automate, and then you enable host automation. Okay. Then it gives it an ID. So now you can go back to the dropdown, go to browse parameter, and it will have whatever you just activated. It will have it listed. So the filter cutoff, let's right click, create an automation clip. So now we can add a filter to the arpeggio that we just created. And let me do this. All right, so that's something OmniSphere specific. So again, you can go through and then accent certain sections. I know. Let's turn it on and off, like in a square type. I'll make it more linear because I don't want to get two step sequence. Shake. So you see, the more open you keep stuff, the more elongated it feels. But once you add the filter, it kind of makes it feel more like, what do you call it? More groove to it. Now, I didn't do faster motion, which DJ Wraith is talking about. Whereas if you do really quick filter stuff, it will create a noticeable effect. So see, that low pass filter makes the sound feel shorter because it's cutting out more of the harmonics. So I can go through and make the sound feel more brassy, but it just will take too much time. So at this point, you just need a bass, and then you could automate the FM amount. So this is usually what they would do in this type of genre house. They would do a sine wave on oscillator A, sine wave on oscillator B, and go to the section right here. I forget what this is called technically. Let me see what this does. This is the warp section, and then switch this to FM from B. Loop the 4-bar, and then you could turn this up over time. Wow. So let's make that an automatable thing. Let's move it, go to your dropdown, browse parameter, and then it should highlight, which is the warp amount. Right click, create an automation clip. So now when you want to add more harmonic content to match your filter movements, you can go in and, you know, make that value higher. Okay, so I forgot to add a baseline. That's kind of what we need to do first. So let me see. You want to do a Catronata type thing? I'll do another thing with the volume that sounds like Catronata, at least to a degree. Let's add a bass. And we want this to start up. Okay, so let's do pattern 4. So we need to drag the pattern in, clone it, and then we need to add notes. Okay, so boom, boom. So boom, boom. All right, so genre is a little more rhythmic, so I need to make smaller notes. It's hard to hear. Get started. Timing all messed up. All I forgot we had chord changes. So we have like four chords in here. I forgot. Okay, so that can't be repeated over and over. Give me a second to map all this out. How'd that get off beat? I'm gonna keep this 1-1-2-3 rhythm. Just gotta map out the note. So sweet G. I know, I'm letting my brain go wild. Sorry, I just didn't read the whole thing. What is it? And Diva. Diva's good for sound designing. I use it a lot for sound design, as well as Serum. I don't use Massive. I haven't used that in a while. Sorry, it's hard for me to read like paragraphs of chat. Give me a second. Okay. Low pass. I'm lost. What was the question? I'm lost. Did I miss something? I didn't see what the question was. With OBS? What about OBS? Then I'm gonna go do do do. Okay, let's pull this down a couple octaves. So if we have this up, then our warped FM amount will be up. I kind of like that duck sound. Connect everything and work. I'm not the greatest like as far as step by step. Actually, let me see. Do I have a video about that? Let me see. Give me a second. I gotta see if I can find it. Da-da-da. Let me play the beat in the meantime. Just give me a second. I think I found a video on it, so I'm gonna send it to your Discord if you're on here. Let me see. I don't even know. I just don't add people on my thing because I just don't feel like getting in conversations with folks. Oh, you're not on Discord. Darn it. I don't even know how to send you the video. There's no messaging app I could even use to send you the video. Yes, I can't do that in real time. I would have to send you a video. I see what you're doing. You're trying to be slick. You're trying to get my email. I would do it over Discord. I have the link, but just the way I learned is really just from YouTube. I hate to sound basic, but I just typed in how to set up OBS for streaming, and I just copied what they did technically. So here's what I'll do. This is a little more advanced. I appreciate you for asking though. What I'll do is I'll add a brassy type tone, and then we're gonna set the envelope over top as an attack curvature over top of the filter. Now this is high level automation. So what I'm gonna do is tell, actually I don't know how to, tell how much the, how would that work? I guess we would do it by the attack time. So we're gonna move the attack time. So hold on me. So if I move the attack time, you get like a slower or faster sound. So let's move the attack time to zero and then see if we could automate this. We should be able to. Yeah, we can. So over time, I can create like a slurry, brassy tone. But yeah, this is the stuff you would do for EDM more so than hip hop. Because, you know, you would have to do a lot of synthesis. Okay. So I'm going to let it slur towards the end. I'm going to increase the attack time. So it goes whoa, 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 like that. I'm just playing with you. I just don't feel like having a correspondence. That's all. I'm being stingy, I guess. But even still, I wouldn't give my email out on YouTube. I mean, that would be crazy. But no, it's more so, do I have your email? I think I even have your email. I'll see if, here, let me write a note. I'll play this beat, and if I have your email, then I'll send it. Yeah, I don't have your email, so I can't send it. But yeah, again, I watch YouTube. So this is the last automation I'll do for this sound. Andrew's here, what's up? So again, it's gonna go whoa, whoa, whoa. Let me solo the bass. Let me make it more dramatic. It's hard to see. Let's do something. So it goes doo doo what like that. So the last thing I'm gonna do, and I'm trying to think of how to do this creatively. How would the trigger, I think it's threshold based. Next beat battle is gonna be Mondays at 8 p.m. Eastern time. So what we wanna do now is have the kick drop the volume of the, let's say the arpeggio. Anything you wanna drop the volume of, let's group it. Let's call it duck. So they usually call this ducking. So yeah, Monday at 8 p.m. Eastern time. We're gonna put all the sounds that we wanna duck in this one group. So let's highlight these, right click the up arrow, go to route to this track only. I would have to go on my, see how much work you're making me do to send you something? Oh my goodness. You could Google it though, to be honest with you. But I shouldn't have to go through these hoops. But yeah, you're right, it is. Let me see if it's DJ Ray. Alright, is there a 38 in here? Is that the one? I'm gonna put the whole thing out there, but is there a 38 in the name? If so, then I'll send it. I think this is it. Oh, your picture popped up. That's a video I only send to my creative agency clients. So you're getting like something that I don't put on YouTube, just to show you what you're getting here. All right, because my guys pay for that in equity. So that was just because you've been supportive and loyal, but I don't give that to everybody. So please don't share that link. All right, so let's get to it. So the duck group, what we need to do is we need to set up a kick, but the kick needs to be, how's this going to work? It's a lot of work. Let's just do gross beat instead. Instead of setting up actual side chaining, let's just do gross beat. and let's just do volume automation. We're just going to draw it in. Let's go to quarter beat, right click, go to single curve, have your trig sync set to your post sync, 4 beats each, and just draw in an envelope for the volume here. So we want it to go down and then up. I did this backwards. Thank you. So this should be this way. Okay, so this is very subtle volume automation. You don't have to do it this way. You could also do it manually. So if you listen to these elements, you'll hear them being ducked. As if a kick's playing, but it's not. I'm just saying it on public record, that's all. See how the creates that bouncy feel? But people think volume is the only thing to automate when it comes to groove. Low pass filters are actually better because they shave off frequency. Exaggerate this, it's hard to hear. Yeah, it's kind of hard to hear the sound at this point. That's how you would do it without making the kick do all the sidechain stuff. There's other ways to sidechain, but that's one way to do it. I didn't really like the sound or the results. There's also kick. I mean, there's also what is it called, Kickstart by Cable Guys. I don't have my license loaded up to show you. And there's Shaper Box as well. So there's other things you could do. Okay, so I think that's all the automation I could think to show you. How long have we been going? I feel my body has been telling me 2 hours have passed, and I knew 2 hours had passed. So I think I'll leave it here because this I need to make it replayable. And we're going to add this on the premium side once it's done rendering to YouTube. So I'm going to give you guys probably, 3 days to watch it on YouTube, and then we're moving it over to premium. So go to premium.busyworksbeats.com. We have free courses for you. Free courses. Thank you, Adam. He says critical hit. There we go. Thank you. So go to premium.busyworksbeats.com. And you guys to sign up for free to go deeper with this stuff. I only touched the surface with the automation. I just don't have time to continue to go over all the other things that we need to go over. So again, Beat Magic is probably the best courses for beat makers specifically on how to learn how to make beats. As far as music theory, we have a course called Music Theory in a Day. That's the best place to start. So I'm going to wrap it here because my body is catching up to me.